Yes, let's continue that we discussed about the Friends of Arcata March, that Arcata wastewater management. Then we came to the Ecosan cycle, that ecological sanitation, the project Ecosan project, sustainable system for handling human excreta using dry composting toilets, a practical, hygienic, efficient and cost effective solution to the human waste disposal. The human excreta can be recycled into a resource as a natural fertilizer, that it reduces the need for chemical fertilizers. Biocompost, usually say, this is the mechanism you see here. There are Ecosan toilets in Kerala and Sri Lanka. Here the conversion, that particular waste material, the organic waste, that means the human excreta is converting in the form of the bio organic waste, that will be helpful for the growth of the plant. So how do we control the water pollution? The Government of India has passed the Water Prevention and Control of Pollution Act 1974 to safeguard the water resources. The holy river Ganga on the screen. So the waste is in their effects, you have to go through. So when it comes to solid waste, it refers to everything that goes out in trash. Municipal solid wastes are wastes from the homes, offices, stores, the schools, hospitals that are collected and disposed by the municipality. All solid wastes cannot be completely burned. The open dumps serve as a breeding grounds for rats and flies. So what they do generally, they make a sanitary landfills. Sanitary landfills, you can see in the diagram. That means a substitute for open burning dumps. Sanitary landfills is a substitute actually. In sanitary landfill, wastes are dumped into in a depression or a trench and covered with the dirt. That these landfills are also having their own limitations. The amount of garbage, especially in metros, has increased so much that these sites are getting filled too. That seepage of chemicals from the landfills pollutes the underground water sources. That means these particular chemicals may travel along the lower side, the soil layers, that may do more pollution. Basically, we can classify the solid wastes into three types: biodegradable, non-biodegradable. Biodegradable, what is biodegradable? They undergo natural breakdown. What is non-biodegradable? The plastic packets, poly bags, polystyrene, we call all they are natural, that non-biodegradable. Along with that, recyclable is there, like plastics and e-wastes. So eco-friendly packaging can be used instead of plastics. The carrying cloth, natural fiber, carry bags, that in that type. Hospital wastes contain disinfectants, harmful chemicals and pathogenic microorganisms, which they are going to be very dangerous. So that's why hospital wastes are disposed, that they should not be released out directly, that they should be disposed in the incinerators, that which incinerators will burn them in high temperature. The electronic waste is nowadays going to be a biggest problem here, that always the next version is coming, people are throwing the older one and moving to the next one. They're all irreparable electronic goods. They're buried in landfills or incinerated. Recycling is the only eco-friendly solution for the treatment of e-wastes, but during recycling, the workers are exposed to the toxic substances present in this e-wastes. It's a big problem now. Till the time it's not solved. But the e-waste amount is going to increase all over the world. Over half of the e-wastes in the developed world are exported to developing countries like China, India and Pakistan, where many metals are recovered during recycling. And now we have our own waste along with that. The success story of Ahmed Khan, that we need to go through, that Ahmed Khan is a plastic manufacturer actually. That years of time he run an industry, the plastic manufacturer actually. But realized his role of pollution in the nature, that by producing the plastic for years of time, nearly 20 plus years of time, he is having run the plastic industry. that realizing himself and he made experiments of his own. That Ahmed Khan, a plastic sack manufacturer in Bangalore, developed a poly blend. That it is a fine powder of recycled modified plastic. The poly blend is mixed with the bitumen and used to lay the roads. The blend of poly blend along with the bitumen, remember these two technical terms, enhances the bitumen's water repellent property and helps to increase the road life. On in Bangalore, you can see the roads which made with the poly blend prepared by Ahmed Khan with the bitumen. They are combining with the bitumen, and he used to pay to that particular people who collects that plastic. He collects that plastic and he started making the poly blend also. Rag pickers, from the rag pickers he used to collect. Okay, let's continue the topic. Agrochemicals and their effects. That inorganic fertilizers, pesticides, herbicides, fungicides are toxic to non-target organisms that are important components of the soil ecosystem. As we discussed about the biomagnification earlier, that biomagnified into the terrestrial ecosystem even. Chemical fertilizers cause eutrophication. We discussed about the anthropological eutrophication, human-made eutrophication. Integrated organic farming. Ramesh Chandra Dhaga. Find the person to be remembered over. Ramesh Chandra Dhaga. It is a cyclical zero-waste procedure where waste products from one process are cycled in as nutrients for other processes. Then this allows the maximum utilization of the resource and increase the efficiency of the production. Ramesh Chandra Dhagar, a farmer in Sonipet, Haryana, included beekeeping, dairy management, water harvesting, composting, and agriculture in integrated organic farming. He is also famous for the small farms, even affordable. That means that's within a small area, 1 hectare area, that he made some nearly 14 lakh rupees income he generated, which he became famous after that. The advantages of the Dhagar integrated organic farming, they support each other and allow an economical and sustainable venture. The no need of chemical fertilizers, as dung is used as manure. The crop waste is used to create the compost, natural fertilizer, or to generate natural gas, provides energy for the farm. Dhagar has created Haryana Kisan Welfare Club to spread information about integrated organic farming. That Dhagar's website is there. If you click, if you search Ramesh Chandra Dhagar along with his photograph, actually I'm sure he's just shown the photograph to you. Ramesh Chandra Dhagar. He is Ramesh Chandra Dhagar. With his organic farming and his earnings, all that you can see here. That in his website, just to search as Ramesh Chandra Dhagar, that's all. Like Ahmed Khan, all their stories are inspirative. Radioactive waste is. Use of nuclear energy has two main problems. Accidental leakage, that we have a great example, Three Mile Island incident and Chernobyl incident. The safe disposal of the radioactive waste is the nuclear radiation causes mutations. It is lethal at high doses. At lower doses, it causes disorders such as cancer. It is recommended to store the nuclear waste in shielded stainless steel containers buried within the rocks or about 500 meters deep below the Earth's surface. But public opposes this method. So greenhouse effect, which is a regular question for us in examination, global warming, greenhouse effect, that what is this exactly? Greenhouse is greenhouse itself. That in ICAR, Indian Council of Agriculture Research, in Rajendra Nagar, when you go everywhere, DOR, Directorate of Oil Research, DRR, Directorate of Rice Research, ICRISAT, wherever you go, you'll find these kind of constructed houses. These are called greenhouses. Then how does our topic named as greenhouses? Our topic is named as greenhouses. That we need to go with a small example. When we take example, you can understand. If you take a car in the hot summer, okay, I am not a good artist. You just understand this as a car. That's all. For your satisfaction, I'll use one more color for tires. Okay, this is the car. I have to sit on the sun also. You may feel bored, that's why I'm doing little bit artwork. Okay, so that when the reflection of the sunlight on earth, then in the car, so what happens that we need to go through? That particular, that on earth will be reflected back. Okay, that's over. But in the car, it will be re-reflected again. This is the criteria that make us to understand the greenhouse. So just why should we go for a greenhouse? Let's take a car to understand much better in summer. When you park on road, after 10-15 minutes, when you back into the car, you feel so hot in the car compared with the outside. Why? Why? Because we can give a technical info, that explanation for that sunlight which entered in the car is re-reflected. The word to be remembered for a greenhouse, that is re-reflection, we say. Re-reflection. Okay, that's why the car temperature is comparatively high in compare with the external temperature. Okay, so the same mechanism we'll find in the greenhouse also. The greenhouse is meant for at lower temperature, growing the plants which can grow only in high temperature. So that is their motive actually. That is their motive. Okay, so that this is the greenhouse. Light will come inside, but that will be re-reflected. So what is our story? Greenhouse is a small glass house used for growing plants during winter. This glass panel lets the light in, but does not allow the heat to escape. That means re-reflection. Then the greenhouse will be warmed up in compare with the outside. That I said the same in car. Then what is greenhouse effect then? It's a natural phenomenon that causes heating the earth surface and atmosphere. It maintains the present average temperature, that 15 degrees centigrade, without greenhouse effect. Actually, without greenhouse effect is necessary. Reflection, re-reflection is required. Without greenhouse effect, the average temperature at earth surface would have been at minus 18 degrees centigrade. But now it is running 15 degrees centigrade because of greenhouse effect only. Greenhouse effect is not effect. But any overdosage can be leads to the effect. You see, what I am saying, effect and effect. So clouds and gases reflect about 1/4 of the incoming solar radiation, absorb some of it. But half of solar radiation falls on the earth that surface heating it, while a small amount is reflected back. The earth surface re-emits heat as infrared radiation, but a part of infrared is absorbed by the atmospheric gas like carbon dioxide and methane, and so cannot escape into the space. So this is the problem, and this sentence to be remembered. Okay, earth surface re-emits the heat as infrared radiation, but a part of infrared is absorbed by the atmospheric gases like carbon dioxide and methane, if you remember, the 2 years back we got this question, and so cannot escape into space. These gases, greenhouse gases, we say, radiate heat energy. Okay, radiate heat energy. Then it comes to air surface, that's heating it up again. It causes the greenhouse effect. So the overheating of the earth due to greenhouse gases is called global warming. During the past century, the temperature of earth has increased by 0.6 degrees centigrade, most of it during the last 3 decades itself. What happens when global warming occurs? That polar ice caps are going to be dissolved. That melting of polar ice caps that increases the ocean levels. Expected to be all the bigger cities like Mumbai, Chennai, Kolkata, which those are at the shores of ocean, they may, that means we are talking in the India point of view, that that when levels of marine water, levels of ocean is increased over, the complete cities will be smashed over. That climatic changes, El Nino effect, we say, the future impact, rise in sea level, that's what we are talking about, rise in sea level that submerges many coastal areas. That what is El Nino? An abnormal weather pattern caused by the warming of the Pacific Ocean near the equator. We say El Nino. The contrast is also their La Nina. An abnormal weather pattern caused by the warming of the Pacific Ocean near the equator, off the coast of South America, is called El Nino. So the control of global warming, reduce the use of fossil fuel, improve efficiency of energy usage, reduce deforestation and plant trees, slowing down the growth of human population. International initiatives are also being taken to reduce the emission of greenhouse gases. These things to be noted down. That ozone depletion, next we are entering into the ozone depletion in the stratosphere. So ozone depletion, as we know that troposphere, stratosphere, ionosphere, exosphere, we use it to classify the atmosphere. That we are in troposphere, that when you go up, we'll find 16 to 18 kilometers up, that we'll find the stratosphere. From the equator, I'm giving this calculation, we'll find the stratosphere. Okay, so if the ozone, the stratosphere contains O3, ozone layer, if the same ozone, O3, if you find in the troposphere, we call it as bad ozone, that lower atmosphere. It harms plants and animals. So where do that O3 should present? That should present in the stratosphere. We say it has good ozone. It's found in the stratosphere. It acts as shield absorbing ultraviolet radiation from the sun. The ultraviolet rays are highly injurious since they cause mutation, the cancers even the rays. The thickness of the ozone in a column of air from the ground to the top of atmosphere is measured in terms of Dobson units. Very, very important. The thickness of the ozone in a column of air from the ground to the top of the atmosphere is measured in terms of Dobson units. So in stratosphere, UV rays act on, these particular UV rays act on molecular oxygen, causing the production of ozone. UV rays also cause the degradation of ozone to O2. This process is balanced actually. But human-made activities now going to be, but this balance is disrupted due to ozone degradation by CFCs, chlorofluorocarbons, used in the refrigerator. The chlorofluorocarbons move upward and reach the stratosphere. The UV rays act on CFCs for the release of chlorine atoms here. The story is from here, you can see in this particular diagram. That these UV rays act on CFCs, releasing chlorine atoms. In presence of chlorine, which is a catalyst, ozone degrades to O2. Ozone degrades to O2, which chlorine acts as a catalyst. That means it won't be spent out. We'll find the chlorine there only. That means your refrigerator from your home, whatever the CFCs, HCFCs, chlorofluorocarbons, which is started from your home towards that 18 kilometers that reach to the stratosphere. And they stay there and they make this particular conversion of the O3 into O2. Generally, it happens. That conversion of the O3 into O2, and then the UV rays also cause the degradation of ozone to O2. But this is process is balanced. Along with that, we also started. That's going to be a bigger problem. In examination point of view, you people need to remember about that chlorine free radical, which they are going to cause the conversion of O3 into O2. UV radiation of wavelengths shorter than UVB are almost completely absorbed by Earth's atmosphere, but UVB causes mutation of DNA. It causes aging of skin, damage to the skin cell, and skin cancer. The high dose of UVB causes inflammation of cornea, snow blindness, we say, that cataract, that it permanently damages the cornea. No blindness to be remembered over. That I can't see here when I say environmental issues. This question came. That the 90% you'll find over the sentences in previous textbooks, previous year question paper. See on the screen, Montreal Protocol. You got this previously. The Montreal Protocol, an international treaty in Canada, 1987, was signed to control the emission of ozone-depleting substances. There are protocols for the developed and developing countries for reducing emission of CFCs and other ozone-depleting chemicals. So then, degradation by improper resource utilization and maintenance, we need to talk about. improper resource utilization and maintenance. That in that the where that one of the issue that soil erosion and desertification, the human activities like over cultivation, deforestation, grazing, overgrazing, and poor irrigation practices leads to soil erosion. It results in arid patches of land and desertification. That increased urbanization also creates a desertification. Increased urbanization also creates desertification. So water logging. What is water logging and soil salinity? Water logging, these are the problems as a part of green revolution. Irrigation without proper drainage of water leads to water logging in the soil. Okay. It draws salt to the surface of the soil. The salt is deposited on the land surface or collects at the plant root. This damage agriculture also. This is water logging. You see, you can see the screen. Deforestation. The conversion of the forested areas to non-forested one. Almost 40% forests have been lost in the tropics compared to only 1% in the temperate region. The National Forest Policy 1988, calculations to be remembered, of India has recommended 33% of the forest cover for the plains and 67% for the hills, but we have only 19.4% of the forest cover. It was about 30% at the beginning of 20th century. Calculations are very important. Reasons for deforestation. The conversion of the forest to agriculture land for timber, firewood, cattle ranching, slash burn agriculture, we use it to say gem cultivation, in the northeastern states of India. In this, the farmers cut down the forest trees and burn the plant remains. The ash is used as a fertilizer. Temporary, we say, because the people will shift from there. After cultivation, the area is left over for several years. So as to allow its recovery. These people will go in some place and they do the same again, that area also. Gem cultivation, we say. So in earlier days, enough time gap was given for recovery, but overpopulation and repeated cultivation decreased the recovery phase, resulting in deforestation. The consequences of the deforestation. Atmospheric carbon dioxide is increased because trees that could hold a lot of carbon in their biomass are lost. Loss of biodiversity due to habitat destruction that disturb the hydrologic cycle, soil erosion and desertification. Reforestation, the process of restoring a forest that once existed in the past. It may occur naturally in a deforested area. However, we can speed it up by planting trees. So, closing with this Bishnoi people, the people's participation in the conservation of the forest. Bishnoi movement, the story when you go back in 1731, the kingdom of Jodhpur in Rajasthan asked to arrange wood for constructing a new palace. The minister and workers went to the forest near a village inhabited by the Bishnois. These are the Bishnois actually. The Bishnois thwarted them from cutting down the trees. A Bishnoi woman, Amruta Devi Bishnoi, hugged a tree that the king's men cut down. The tree along with Amruta Devi, her three daughters, means those offered there instead of one tree, that they offered their head. So that her three daughters, hundreds of Bishnois, were also lost their life saving trees. So this is the story of these particular Amruta Devi and her daughters, three daughters. Vishu, Bigu, like some daughter names are there. So we should know what is Bishnoi actually. Bishnoi is not there. The family name. Vishnoi is a culture. Vishnoi is a tradition. That if you go little bit back, more back there to the 1731, that like Buddhism, like Jainism, Vishnoism is also a particular culture, we say. That we need to know little bit of that. Vishnoi people, that like Gautam Buddha, there is a Vishnoi. that he made some culture, he made some religion, which in that religion, around 60% of the rules are in favor of nature. That means mostly these people are naturalist racing, Vishnoi religion people. Like how we say Hindus, Muslims, Buddhists, Jains, Vishnoi is also a religion actually. So this Amruta Devi Vishnoi is from that Vishnoi religion. So which they have more concern about that particular nature. So that was the first story. Vishnoi religion is born and the Amruta Devi and the three daughters which belongs to the Vishnoi religion. And the story number three at present, Government of India was instituted that Amruta Devi Vishnoi Wildlife Protection Award for individuals or communities from rural areas for extraordinary courage and dedication in protecting wildlife. With that inspiration, Chipko movement is raised in Garhwal, Himalayas. In 1971, Medha Patkar is the leading person there in that time. At the time, the local women participated to protect trees from the acts of contractors by hacking them. Sundarlal Bahuguna and Medha Patkar, the main people there. So the Government of India in 1980s introduced the concept of joint forest management to work closely with the local communities for protecting and managing forests. In return, for their services, the communities get benefit of forest products like fruits, gum, rubber, medicine, etc. Okay, so this is all about the pollution topic here. That's all about the pollution, environmental issues. As I said to you, you please make notes while reading the text. Please make notes. Okay.